Welcome back to Feels Like Weezer, where we're discussing all the songs of Weezer, song by song, track by track, year by year, from Blue Album to most recently Van Weezer. I'm Eric Nash from Almost Famous Minute.
And my name is Martin David Tapia. I'm a songwriter and amateur musician.
And today we have a guest. He is...
I'm James Anderson from Can't Hardly Wait Minute and Timeline Scavengers podcast.
Hey, James, great to have you with us today.
I just realized that I was on the Almost Famous Minute on your April Fool's Day episode
Yeah, right. But I have heard you before.
Right.
So I definitely listened to that. Well, thanks so much for, jumping in when I think Zach put the call out.
Absolutely.
And you chose. You got the cream of the crop here.
Oh, yeah.
Track number two, but we're listening to it's our first for the Rabbit album because we're going singles first when they came out before the album did, at least digitally too, in this case. The Greatest Band That Ever Lived, Variations on a Shaker Hymn.
Yeah.
And we'll definitely try to understand why that was added at one point, apparently. So we'll listen to a little clip of it now, or maybe many little clips. that was pretty interesting sounding. So let's throw to Martin this time, if that's okay with you, Martin. Do you have a bit of a take on it right off the bat?
Absolutely. There's a lot that goes on in this song. There are a lot of different parts, and if we want to, there's probably a lot we could say about it. But I think whether or not any of us likes it, and I guess we'll go into whether that's the case. Yeah, there's a lot to this song. There are a lot of different parts. Rivers Cuomo wrote it, and he was inspired by a few different bands, right? So the first part's the hip hop part. The second part's the
Slipknot.
Oh, yeah.
The Slipknot. Yeah, I don't know that I've ever really tried to listen to Slipknot even. I know the band name, but
yeah. Some of these feel like a stretch to me. Yeah. I don't know if I really agree with most of them.
And really, I think one of my favorite is one that I really don't... I'm not too into the band. So.
Okay.
Yeah, what's it? But tell us.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right.
No, Weezer stretch. Yeah, which one, Eric?
The Aerosmith one.
Mm.
One of two, I think, essentially falsettos.
Yeah.
That's probably my favorite part too. When Rivers comes in with that high vocal, it's pretty powerful, I would say. I love that part too.
I mean, I do have like two CDs or albums, whatever, but they're not like as much of. I think like I should try to go back and listen to more of their classics, but I've done it a little bit maybe, but try some more. Yeah.
I mean, my mom got me a double disc from Costco back in 1999 or something, and those are the only full-length Aerosmith albums I've ever needed or wanted.
Yeah, that makes sense. So, I only think of Aerosmith when I'm, and this actually kind of comes up a lot, but when I'm trying to stay awake, because I'll just be like, I don't want to close my eyes.
Right, exactly.
I don't want to fall asleep, yeah.
Yeah, I also, when I'm worried about I'm going to miss something, I start.
Yeah. Or, anytime I'm going through my daily viewing of a Armageddon, right?
Armageddon,
yeah.
Sure.
Sorry. Oh. Yeah. I watch it every day, yeah. So, yeah, what were we talking about? Where are we going?
Yeah, the sections of the song, for sure.
And then there's Green Day, there's a... choral section.
Yeah. Nirvana.
There's Nirvana section.
Kinda.
Jeff Buckley.
Who is... I don't even know who Jeff Buckley is.
Okay.
Yeah. Tell me. Educate me on Jeff Buckley.
He came in the early, mid-90s, and he was kind of this, he's not there on the stage solo. He definitely has his backing band, but he's known, it's kind of that singer-songwriter vibe a bit.
Yeah.
But with a good bit of electric going on, electric guitar and other instruments too, I'm sure. But that are thrown in and out. But just his singing style was not that grungy sound.
Yeah.
It was more polished,
yeah.
But very, very emotional.
If you've ever heard a version of Hallelujah that
right,
isn't
yeah.
by Leonard Cohen, it's by Jeff Buckley.
Or it's Rufus Wainwright, right?
Right, right.
The Shrek one.
Right, of course. Yes, of course. That classic.
Is the next most popular.
Shrek soundtracks come up more in my life than I ever realized that they would. I'm like, and they're not in my life. It's just I'll be like, and then this, and they'll be like, and the Shrek soundtrack. I'm like, okay, and which is good and cool, but it's like unexpected. Jeff Buckley's dad was also a famous musician.
Yeah, Tim Buckley.
Yeah.
So just real quick, would you two recommend that I do a deep dive into some Jeff Buckley?
It's weird to use the word deep dive.
Yeah.
Yeah. He drowned.
Poor choice.
Yeah, and also he released, I think,
RIP.
One album. So like,
the one main studio album, right, is what I have. And I've listened a bit to some of his live stuff, essentially. I mean, a live album and maybe a couple YouTube videos. But...
Yeah, but I would say yes. The answer is yes, but...
but unfortunate phrasing. Okay, I get it.
Yeah.
Listen, you didn't know.
Yeah.
Sometimes the universe does that to us, and it's just...
Yeah. I actually love it. I feel, well, maybe... Yeah, okay. Let's move on from that.
Dark puns are yes.
So we mentioned Andrew Sisters, and I think Green Day. Did you say that too? So then Elvis Presley.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Is the only other one. That's the spoken word.
Well, they got,
well actually,
we got
actually
Bach
besides,
and
right,
here.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
true. Too.
Yeah.
A little.
And it says, I'm looking at the Wikipedia to follow along with the sections, and it says spoken word inspired by Elvis. This sort of feels like Boyz II Men did that a lot. Where it's
okay.
like,
yeah, sure.
Like the music keeps going. But someone's gonna just talk to you for a sec.
It very possibly the reason for this is probably because Elvis did it. Elvis was known for doing it, I guess.
Yeah.
Belle and Sebastian's song, A Century of Elvis.
Right.
Oh, nice.
Which has
yeah.
an alternate version of Century of Fakers, where he does sing. They do sing.
Yeah, but, exactly. Yeah. Oh, that's cool. That's a nice connection that I never would have thought of. Good one, Eric.
Yeah,
thank you. But then, like, I was actually surprised you don't know Jeff Buckley, but you do know Andrew Sisters, Martin?
I know, like, enough? I've heard a couple of Andrew Sisters songs.
Yeah, same here, essentially.
But,
and I saw them in black and white, you know, back on, like, Jack Benny's show,
that
my dad and I would love to watch when I was, you know, kid, preteen, what have you. Boogie Woogie Bugle Boy.
Yep.
And Don't Sit Under the Apple Tree.
Rum and Coca-Cola.
Yeah.
The Christmas song that they did with Bing Crosby, which is, hold on.
Boogie Woogie Christmas Boy?
Big Boogie Woogie Christmas Boy, yeah. It's a classic of the company Rudolph.
Yep.
And... people said that they were shoehorning lyrics, and I just don't agree. I think they're solid.
I see Christmas Island and Merry Christmas Polka.
I think Jingle Bells is the most famous one, where it's like, yeah. I know that Jingle Bells is sort of a weird anticlimactic answer to this what Christmas song is. But they famously do sort of a... And Melikaliki Maka, I guess, is also another one.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
That they are pretty famous for. I also don't agree with this one very much either.
Okay. The Andrew Sisters. Yeah. So is there another band? There's another band that I thought of.
Oh yeah. What do you think it sounds like?
What do you think
Eric?
Of? Yeah.
They might be giants.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I can see that.
Let's listen to it again.
I hear that for sure. Yeah. I would say it sounds more like they might be giants, or like easily than it does the Andrew Sisters.
I mean, could it be that They Might Be Giants was ripping off Andrew's Sisters, and we just didn't know it?
Maybe.
I didn't know.
I mean, I don't peg them for anything, but
no.
maybe.
Yeah.
But
I'm sure. go on.
They did Istanbul, and I mean that's this old,
absolutely,
know,
absolutely
that same era.
All of these, like the choral one and the Bach and the Beethoven one, fine, but some of these just feel like eras of Weezer more than other. Like, there was a song. Do you guys know the band Save the Day?
Ooh, sounds a little familiar, but
they
I kind of, a little bit. I know.
Like
of them,
they're like a New Jersey pop punk emo-y sort of. Yeah. They were sort of being like the early 2000s. They had a song on one of their later albums called Bones, which is three parts. And the way I think of it is, it drifts back in their career. So it starts off sounding the most like them, then middle level, and then early. And this sort of feels like it's doing something similar, only shuffled up. Because, like,
yeah.
The rap is like El Scorcho. And then we got other stuff for, you know, from, like, Make Believe and Pinkerton and other places and stuff. I don't know. Did Rivers Cuomo, like, is this the list that he said that they were?
Yeah, I really couldn't figure that out. Just how they came upon that.
Is it, so...
Yeah.
So it says he has stated some of the artists,
okay.
And others are self-explanatory.
Well, okay.
So which ones are which? I have no idea.
Okay, the Corral one is self-explanatory. But Green Day, I came back and I was like, yeah. Green Day, really? Because like Billy Joe Armstrong's voice is so iconic that it sort of just sounds like Weezer if you don't have Billy Joe Armstrong's voice. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Well, there's a video. Did you guys watch? There's a video of Rivers in a hotel room.
Yeah.
And he's just like explaining the song, and he pretty much says that like the original idea for it was like he had like all the sections, and he just started with that, and it seems like it went through a lot of changes, but
yeah.
Like the actual like little sections and like the ideas of like what bands he wanted to pay homage to. It seems like didn't change, right? I mean, that's what it seemed like from that little video that I watched.
I didn't see that one. Slipknot feel. I don't know. I don't know. These all feel sort of like if you've heard people talk about these bands before, and not actually listened to them. Maybe.
I mean, Slipknot does kind of... It seems like a joke, maybe. Rivers is just kind of, like, fooling around with... I don't know. Just, like,
know.
doing a different style and then, like, post-hoc being like, oh, yeah, this is a Slipknot homage, right?
Yeah.
That's what it seems like.
I could see that.
I'm surprised that, like some of them, like that one, say, didn't have, like, oh, it's Slipknot or it's this or it's that. You know,
yeah.
like two or three or four different bands mentioned. For some of these, maybe.
I knew one day a Weezer song would make me say, I guess I need to go listen to Slipknot, but I never realized that it would be this song. Is it funny and ironic to you guys as it is to me that this is, it's not based on, because he didn't realize he was doing it, but it's reminiscent of Simple Gifts, so it's like, 'tis a gift to be simple, and it's an 11-part different, you know, 6-minute song with all these different things, like, okay, well, or not. It's all, sometimes it's a gift to be complicated, I guess.
You know what? Sometimes it's simple to be complicated.
That's true.
Is it though? I don't think it makes any
sense.
Isn't
it? Or does it make the most sense?
Well, maybe it's more complicated to be simple. But, yeah.
So let's go into that a little bit if you're up for it. So apparently at least like the real melody,
yeah.
You know, is by this Joseph Brackett, who isn't really the true initial songwriter of it. I would assume it's more of a lyric thing that happened by apparently Joseph or no I'm sorry.
He was a shaker.
Right there. Yeah.
And. It's like Amazing Grace was an existing hymn sound, but then another Christian guy put lyrics to it. I think that's sort of what we're looking at here.
But nonetheless, I mean, it's really all about the melody, the tune, and that it was so at first when I was like finding out a little bit about this, just you know because of the podcast, I hadn't looked into it before then.
Oh, okay.
You know, as to why this had. The parenthesis variations on, but you know I just like at first I was just assuming, oh, well, there's maybe just like this one little part that's in it that had this thing. But mm-hmm. no, it is what it says, variations on, and that's what that repeated yeah. melody in this song.
Absolutely.
You know, and that just that is what happens to be, you know, coincidentally, as far as we know, Rivers hadn't heard it before.
I find that hard to believe.
Find it dubious as well.
Because the story is that Brian Bell's mom showed up in the studio and she noted to them, hey, this sounds like this other thing I know.
Well, we also know that these Weezer boys can tend to be jokesters from time to time or, you know, say things in interviews that aren't necessarily true. So it's hard to tell.
I also think, what is the problem? It's not like Weezer would be the first one to rip off a hymn for pop music. That's just sort of like what pop music used to be, is just ripping off hymns and turning God into baby, or you know, Jesus into baby and God into love, and that's it. Like, I don't understand who he was worried about offending here.
I don't know if they were, maybe they weren't worried, but maybe it was just like a little goof that they decided to say at one point, and it just kind of stuck. But, speaking of hymns and pop songs, in this hymn, Simple Gifts in particular, I just, there were a couple things in the Wikipedia article about it in pop culture. One, R.E.M. used the song for the opening for a song that they wrote called I Believe during their work tour in 1987. I don't know if Rivers ever has mentioned R.E.M. in interviews or, like, if they're an influence on him, but it seems like he must have at least heard them. So I'd say there's a possibility that he...
By this point. But...
I mean, he definitely, everybody's, heard R.E.M., I guess. But, and Rivers seems like a guy who likes music, so I'm sure he was aware. But I wonder if he had heard that through R.E.M., so maybe that's where he picked it up. And then another one of note is that John Williams used Simple Gifts as a basis for a composition for... I wrote it down.
Barack Obama's inauguration?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah. I just wrote down the name. Okay, never mind. I didn't write it down. But yeah, a song that was used in Barack Obama's inauguration. That was in 2009. So that was after this song came out, The Greatest Man That Ever Lived. So I'm assuming that John Williams was
100%.
He was
listening to The Greatest Man That Ever Lived, and he's like, oh, this track is a banger. I'm going to use it for Obama's inauguration.
John Williams, big Weezer fan. Big of Red course. Album fan, actually.
Yeah,
only Red album. Only
well,
likes the Red album.
Yeah, John Williams is the biggest
hey, Red
album
my
fan.
Color.
I love it. Okay.
The Appalachian Spring, the Aaron Copland ballet, is pretty... pretty widespreading too, so I'm wondering if that's another possible source of Weezer's, well, but like unintentional, you know, cribbing.
Yeah.
I also it makes me absolutely fascinated when like you listen to a song and you're like, did they know or was that just like this sounds good, and it's like, oh no, that it sounds good because it's that song, not this song. Like.
Yeah. Right. Well, I mean, that's a big argument kind of against, I think, sampling.
But I would make the argument for, like, use the original then. Then people know you know it and see what you're doing with it, as opposed to, oopsie, Nirvana, you accidentally ripped off this other band.
Oh, crap, why can't I think of them? Killing Joke.
Right. Yes.
The one other thing that I think besides the various parts and that tune, but then I'm back to the various parts, but not any one specific, is the whole idea of songs like this.
Right.
So there's one that has just been a huge one for me for quite a while since about 2000-ish. But there's certainly the others I knew about before then. You know, probably ones that you guys might say would be like Bohemian Rhapsody.
Yeah.
Say.
Which has five parts. I like to think Rivers was like, five parts, double plus one, here we go.
and then I mean, one they've covered is Paranoid Android.
Sure.
Which actually kind of took from the Beatles, Happiness is a Warm Gun. It was their biggest inspiration for doing
sure.
is my understanding. While even though I'm sure they knew Bohemian Rhapsody at that point in 96, 97, when they put that on OK Computer. But so the one I'm actually after, I'm wondering if you guys know about, The Who, A Quick One While He's Away.
Oh, for sure.
Okay, wonderful.
For sure. Live
and on. Martin?
I've never heard this.
Okay, song. I'm going to get you a link.
Hey, Martin, you are forgiven.
Okay, I get that. I understand.
Song.
Yeah.
It's in the song, I think.
Now I know what song you're talking about. I just didn't know it by the
you
title.
Do,
yeah.
Because how
Rushmore?
I came across it. Right, exactly.
Yeah, okay.
I came across it because of Rushmore.
Yeah.
But then right around that same time, I think I also got from the library, I picked it up, and then I've since thankfully got it actually. Well, I think it's come out. I forget how I got. I got digitally more recently. Rolling Stones, Rock and Roll Circus. It was a British, a single, like variety show, single episode variety that they meant to. They wanted to put on air. I don't think it actually got on air back in the late '60s when it was recorded. And so it sat dormant for quite a while until like the '90s, and that's when Anderson grabbed that. I think he's using that version, that live version.
Oh wow!
In that, so I mean they have the studio version, but they also have at least a couple live versions.
The one I've heard is there's a live at Leeds.
Okay.
One time I was like, I want to listen to The Who, and I know they smashed their instruments live, so I will listen to the audio experience of a live album, so that. I don't know what the next thought in my logic was, but then after I bought Live at Leeds, and they're like, this is what we call Tommy's parents is the quick one.
Right.
Yeah. It's a good song.
I guess the one that I'll bring up real quick is maybe a song that a future guest might bring up on a next episode. We don't know because it hasn't happened yet. But Fingertips, you already mentioned they might be giants.
Oh, sure. For sure.
Yeah. I feel that one's a little bit more disjointed, but this song, like, the segments of it don't necessarily flow that naturally into each other. They do kind of, like, just, like, jump from one to the other pretty abruptly. So that's just another song that I thought was kind of similar that I thought I'd bring up.
Doesn't this feel to you like like a hulked-out version of El Scorcho, though? Like... Hey, like El Scorcho, what if we did that, but more, like even more?
I like that idea. I never thought about it like that before. But yeah, I love it. I love the idea of El Scorcho getting some gamma radiation and becoming the greatest man that ever lived.
I'm looking at all these reviews that are like, Weezer shouldn't rap, and I'm like, see? Go back and listen to Pinkerton. This is not new.
True. Wow, there's so much to talk about. I feel like we could keep going on, and we should keep going on. But I just want to talk about like the parts of the song that I really like my very favorite parts, because there's a lot to it. I'm just gonna go through the highlights for me. For one, Eric, you already mentioned the falsetto on the Aerosmith part, I think, like, really hits hard for me. That's great. The line, if you don't like it, you can shove it, but you don't like it, you love it? Dang, that's hard as fuck. Like,
I've had that in my head since we started recording.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's like I think about that line all the time, and it's very good and very clever. And it's a lot of fun.
And for that section, I wondered if either of you might have had a similar thought to me, which is, he goes in act one, blah, 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 and act two, blah, blah, blah. But I thought, like, does he say act, when I was re-listening it over and over again, and then one time I was thinking, like, is he going to go into, is he going to say act three? because I mean most movies, I'm awfully sure movies. That's kind of what, you know, where we're at in society. We don't talk too much about plays,
right?
Plays,
right.
Whatever. But you know, generally most have three acts.
Right.
Or three
right.
act structure. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, it's interesting. I found it interesting when I realized that. I said,
yeah.
Does he say act three here? No, he doesn't. Okay. Well, so is that, you know, the idea of it's to come, you know.
Yeah. Right.
And I've heard this about act twos, is that's what all comic books are, essentially.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, they're
like
all the single issues that, you know, go on for the longest time in long-running comic books, Batman or Spider-Man or whoever.
Well, there's like a past,
all,
present,
all
future
act two stories.
Too.
Yeah, generally.
Like if act one is past, and like, you know, in act one I couldn't whatever, and in act two is the, like, you know, but now, you know, and then but now, and then in the future, kind of a, you know, past, present, future sort of deal too. It also reminds me of like going back to like maybe like a Motown sound, like that Motown spoken word,
huh?
Or like a like leader of the pack kind of,
mm-hmm.
like a girl group kind of, let's take a second to tell this story thing. I also was sort of hearing that.
Yeah, the Shangri-Las. I can hear
yeah.
that in there for
yeah.
sure.
Do you guys know the Are You Lonesome Tonight spoken word? I'm not very familiar with that.
I mean, I can hear that line, that title,
sure,
being sung in my head, but I can't.
Yeah, I don't think so.
I hear
I'm
that,
sure I've heard
that song title, and then I go into Bella Notte from Lady and the Tramp. So I know that's not right, but they are the same song in my head. So
yeah.
Sorry, all the fans, but
that's okay. Now they're the same song in my head too, so I think that's fine. Just one thing that I wanted to say really quick about the beginning of that is, and this is directly from the Are You Lonesome Tonight. Like, Rivers just took the spoken word part from the beginning of that, but the fact that they say somebody said that all the world's a stage, I think it's kind of, like, just funny. Like, we all know who that somebody
yeah.
is. Like, you know, somebody once said, I don't know who, but somebody once said that all the world's a stage.
I like that with the theme of Rivers Cuomo is the greatest man that ever lived, so Shakespeare doesn't even get a name drop.
Yeah, he's uh-huh. just some schmo.
Some guy.
Yeah.
Well, so now you mentioned that part. I mean, that's certainly this repeated thing, and it's the title of the song, "The Greatest Man That Ever Lived." I
yeah.
mean, you know, well, just that title itself. That's not saying I'm the greatest man, you know, but certainly in the song, it's sung that way. That, you know, but then so I think a little bit, you know, I mean, it's very braggadocious, you know, braggy,
right. yeah.
And so the other great song that I thought of, and actually just like, I think I listened to it last night even, but didn't even realize, I mean, I just now realized, oh, I listened to that, and I'm you know, we were talking about this today, is Ringo Starr's song, I'm the Greatest.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Which apparently was helped co-written with John Lennon.
Right.
So,
right.
That whole album actually features at least co-writings, if not some performances by all three other Beatles.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's the last time they were all on
album.
The same
yeah.
record together,
yeah.
right? Until,
yep.
Yeah.
Still an anthology. So,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I like the braggadocious part with the rap element of it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It fits in with that. Actually, interesting. I mean, like Nirvana, no, but like a lot of these are sort of, actually, no. That thesis I was about to say, no. I like it with the rap stuff because it fits with that sort of you know, whole style. But then I wonder if each time he switches genres,
yeah.
we're being asked to examine "I Am the Greatest Man That Ever Lived" through like this genre's
mm-hmm.
like connotations. Like, is Nirvana being ironic
yeah.
in that section when he's saying, I am the greatest man that ever lived? That kind of stuff.
Yeah, it's fitting so much more the style that they do.
Yeah.
It's fitting better that for what's being said, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, yeah. So, like, look, I mean, look at the Jeff Buckley one and what we told you, Martin, about him. I mean, you know. you know, him dying early, much, but I mean, it's much like certainly Cobain, but right. But you know, yeah, I may not be here when you call, you know.
Mm-hmm. Oh wow! Yeah.
And this is definitely post him dying. That's for sure.
Yeah. Right.
Well, I've got kind of like a unifying theory of this song, like the overall arc. Like basically, it like there is like the braggadocious element, and I think that's cool. But the chorus is like the main thing that gets me. Like I think that it's maybe not ironic, or like I don't know. It's kind of like a way of having it both ways, like having it be ironic
for sure.
And. Then, like, have, like, and I don't know if you guys have ever, like, written a song or, like, done something, like, made a piece of art or done something that, obviously, we've all done something that we're proud of. But I think there's, like, a feeling when you do that where you're, like, oh, wow, I'm a really powerful person. Like, I did this thing. I brought it into the world. It feels
yeah.
great. And I can only imagine that feeling times, like, a million. If you're like somebody like Rivers Cuomo, where like you have written a ton of songs that have been like gigantic radio hits, like it must be
right.
like super gratifying. And then,
yeah.
So then there's the other element where a lot of this stuff, especially in like the first verses, well, even at the end kind of, or in the spoken word part is about sex, right?
Mm.
So yeah. then there's like in the chorus, there's the lyric, I was born to give, right? And that's,
mm-hmm.
like, maybe a little pun for, like,
sure.
giving is, like, fucking, right?
Right.
So that's, like, one way to look at it. But then the other way to look at it is the altruistic way of, like, I was born to, like, you know, make you happy, right?
Right. Right.
And there was... Well, that, I mean, that ties into my other show, which I mentioned at the beginning, Almost Famous. Because there's definitely the wonderful monologue that a couple monologues that Cameron Crowe and Jeff Beebe, played by Jason Lee, you know Kevin Smith does wonderful for his monologues as well. But you know where he says, yeah, I look for that one guy not getting off at a concert, and I get him, I make him get off. You know, so yeah.
So, yeah, I think that's the way that I read it overall is just that little dichotomy between, like, the base needs of the flesh going with the religious angle of the Shaker hymn, and then, like, the higher calling of, like, creating something, doing something good, making something good in the world. And there's a quote that is from the Weezerpedia that I didn't see attributed to anybody, but it was written there. I'm just going to read it off. It says, "Was I born to give? What does that mean? Is he bragging about his potency, or is he beginning to show his other, deeper, more altruistic side? I don't know the answer. I was just asking you." And I think that kind of ties into, Eric, what you were saying. Like, the third act is, like, unknown.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that's like the answer. This song is asking the question, and then the third act would be the answer, and we'll see. I guess for Rivers, which way it goes. Maybe he's just gonna, like, as he gets older, he's just gonna become a complete like hedonistic fuck machine. We don't know. Or maybe he's gonna write like even more and more beautiful songs as he gets older.
Not Tired of Sex Anymore.
Yeah, that's the sequel. I can't wait. That sounds like a great song. I really want to hear that one.
You know what kind of bugs me is that rap is one of the only non-artist attributed, like, direct, like, one, this one artist. As a
yeah.
Like, I know Coral isn't either, but, like, surely if we've gone so far as to say what happens between 1 minute and 1 minute 26 is Slipknot, surely we can pick out a rap artist.
Absolutely.
That
it does
sound
feel
like.
Probably Kanye, maybe. I mean, at least now, but back then, gosh.
Yeah, for sure feels a little bit reductive. But
yeah.
This also reminds me of, like, a little joke that my friends and I used to have in high school, because did you ever notice that people like, maybe, I don't know how old you are, James, but maybe Eric and I, like, when we were in high school, there used to be people with ska, like, just ska patches, like, just the word ska.
Okay.
People would be like,
or punk.
I've never seen anybody with a patch that just said punk before.
Okay. Well,
okay. Well, that's kind of the same idea. It's funny, and we always used to say it'd be funny if somebody had, like, a patch that just said rap. Like, I don't know. It's just...
That would be fun. I agree that would be funny.
Okay. Well, that's a little joke from my high school years.
I think that one of the things is that if you reduce these to genre, you have much less parts. I think that some of these are extended because I think Rivers said there are 11 parts. And so they're like, all right, this part's Aerosmith, but this part's Nirvana because they are going faster or whatever. But this part is Green Day because who on earth knows why they said that. But if you had rap and then hard rock and then whatever, I think it would be like maybe six parts or something. Mm-hmm. And then how do you stick it to Queen if you only do six parts is what I'm saying.
Okay. So you think the whole point of this song was to just do a little better than Queen, to have more parts of the song than Queen.
Well, actually, I don't know if you guys saw this. I was looking in the great. It was originally called "The Greatest Man That Ever Lived." Parentheses, take that, Queen. I don't know if you guys saw that.
Oh, that makes sense. It's all coming together.
Brian Bell's mom is a big Queen fan, so she found a way there. Just real quick, Jeffrey Canino from Tiny Mixtapes said that the rap section reminded him of Fred Durst, and I want to say that I disagree very much with that. So, but I mean, I guess I can hear why he's thinking that, but that's sort of like a maybe listen to more rap music before you say things.
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe. I mean, like, oh, I forgot Rick Rubin produced this. Oh, okay. There's a lot of stuff that sort of falls into place with like the metal and rap together stuff when you get Rick Rubin.
Yeah, that's true. I didn't even think of that. And also Rick Rubin, just as a little side note, was the one who suggested Are You Lonesome Tonight for the spoken word part. Rivers was like, what's a good spoken word part in a song? And I guess he asked Rick Rubin, and Rick Rubin was like, Are You Lonesome Tonight? And then Rivers took a lot of it just whole cloth from that song and just slapped it onto his song, which I love. I love when people steal other people's songs. I do it all the time. Don't tell anybody.
Yeah, although stealing from Elvis feels particularly nice, I feel like, maybe.
Absolutely.
I gotta say, the Weezer part at the end feels like a celebration. It almost feels like they're... like it's building to this. Like, oh my gosh, wait a minute. What is this building? I mean, I think that Rivers likes rap more than this, what I'm about to say is going to indicate, but what if it's building to the greatest man that ever lived, which is, it sounds like Weezer. Because, like, you got Bach and Beethoven right
before No. The title is Feels Like Weezer.
Sorry. Which show am I on? Hello?
No, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
But I wonder if it's building to, like, it's almost like a reverse countdown, where it's like, or I guess, no, normal countdown. The normal, the regular kind of countdown, where it's...
A reverse countdown.
The regular way. Down to number one, which is Weezer, which, if you look at it that way, he's saying... And Bach and Beethoven are number two. So here I am. And like by the end of the song, it's a little hard to disagree because that Weezer sound is so like, I don't want to be that guy. I really don't want to be that guy. But please make more songs that sound like the last 30 seconds of this song. Like, I love that sound so much. And I know that we have albums full of it, but like, it feels like a drink of water sometimes to listen to this song progress to that.
All right, are you listening, Rivers? Do it.
Noted fan, Rivers.
Yeah, I know he listens to the show.
Right.
And, from your lips to Rivers Cuomo's ears.
As the saying goes.
Yeah, exactly. The next album is going to be all throwbacks, Blue Album throwbacks. It's gonna be My Name Is Jonas popular. Part 2.
Well, that's kind of what we thought we were going to be getting with Van Weezer, and I really kind of need to listen to that more. I mean, there was that Blue Dream song that I think some people were kind of theorizing was going to be a bit, you know, blue album sound. I forget if it is or not. I need to listen to that one particular song, I think, more.
That's the one with Ozzy as a co-writer.
Yeah.
Oh, that's
well,
the one?
Well, not truly co-writer.
Right. Oh, they just sampled,
just
they
because,
sampled an
yeah,
Ozzy
right.
song.
Right.
Okay.
They, need, right. they had the credit.
Oh, Crazy Train. Right.
Yeah.
Gotcha. This is also, did anyone say why is Weezer dipping their toe into metal? Because it's the same answer as why is Weezer dipping their toe into rap. It's because Rivers Cuomo. Like, have you listened to anything by him before? Like, he has these interests that he's talked about from the very beginning, and I don't.
Yeah.
People that you can tell people that don't, not to like hipster anyone, but like you can tell people don't really listen to the music they're reviewing when they say stuff like that.
Well, I mean, with the rap thing, I mean, you know, I mean, it's right off the bat with their song Buddy Holly,
right?
With that, I mean, even though it's singing, but he sings, homie.
Right. It's yes. It's exactly.
Homie, this.
Yeah, and then like the middle eight part, yeah. Even in Buddy Holly, yeah. The bridge part is like a little bit.
That's a little bit of a little bit of a rap, yeah, for sure.
Kind of, yeah.
Kind of for 1994 alternative
yeah.
white guy.
Exactly.
We can give that to them, I think.
Yeah. Weezer and Beck, that's it.
Right. And I believe the Beastie Boys were putting out back then too. But
oh my gosh.
Yes, but I think Weezer and Beck and the Beastie Boys is what we say.
I mean, they were new on the scene.
For sure.
Beastie Boys have been around for 10 years prior.
Beastie Boys are like, listen, this is our lane, please leave.
Yeah.
Did he stay homie in that song? Yeah. Get him.
you were mentioning the last segment, the Weezer segment, and in that, and actually kind of bringing back something I think I was doing like in the Blue and maybe a little bit of the Pinkerton episodes, but kind of got away from my little other segment kind of thing. Martin,
okay.
hint, maybe. But it's that, things that I kind of misheard.
Okay.
Upon either small number or many, many, many number of listens like it was for Blue, that's for sure.
Do you have a name for this segment?
Misheard?
Do you know the term Mondegreen?
That doesn't sound fair.
Mondegreen is the term for misheard lyrics. There's a poem that's like laid him on the green, but people heard Lady Mondegreen.
Oh, cool.
So Mondegreen album might be.
Yeah. That's really good. All right, that's the name of the segment. Here's a little note to me in the future: write a theme song for this segment, and Zach will stick it in once I write it. Okay.
Hey, hello. It's yours truly, Martin David Tapia. I'm just popping in to tell you that, sadly, I did not record a song for the Misheard Lyrics section of the show. I'm really sorry. I love you, and I want this podcast to be the best podcast for you that I can make, but I just haven't had a lot of time recently. I'll try to have a fun theme song if we do this segment on future shows. Okay? All right. Back to the show. Thanks. Bye.
Go, Eric.
So the thing here in the last segment, and actually it's what in the one or two prior, maybe just one. The word radioactive.
Hmm.
I think when I was hearing it, I don't know if it, maybe it was only the other one or two segments that I kind of thought about this then. But I was thinking I was in the mindset of radio.
Me too.
You know.
Me too. Absolutely.
So then the other weird thing about though in this last segment that I did highlight was the D act,
yeah,
you know, those two or three times that segment of the word is repeated by him and the backup singers, Brian and Scott, and maybe Pat. I don't know. So this is another thing we often sometimes we'll talk about watching on YouTube them perform it live.
Okay.
So it's definitely like when I was seeing them, you know, sing it live and seeing that they were singing the backup, and it felt more normal to me, that, you know, more okay. I got more into it, I guess. But at first, when I was prepping for the show and realizing, oh, they're just singing, you know, D-Act, you know, that same other word by itself, it rubbed me the wrong way for a moment. But then, thankfully, I watched them live.
I have never heard the word radioactive before until in my head right now listening back. I have thought it's radio-I is what I've heard. Radio-I.
Okay.
Which actually puts me in the mind of Radio Gaga, which is also by Queen, and therefore my thesis is still solid.
Definitely. And they're also looking towards the future with Imagine Dragons, so too.
Right, exactly, of course. And that's the third act.
Yeah.
And so it's the future, so it's Imagine Dragons. It all holds up.
So Imagine Dragons, whoever the guy from Imagine Dragons is, he's the greatest man who ever lived, right? That's what this song is about?
I think that's pretty much, that's undeniable. Airtight logic, for sure. Yeah. We solved it.
Very good. I've heard radioactive every time. You guys are
really.
You guys are dumb dumb.
I just like the radio so much. We hear what we want to hear, and I want to hear the radio.
All right. Do we want to move on to what are our segments? Oh, do we want to talk about the left channel, right channel? Do we have anything that we want to add here on the end? Talking about the song proper. We didn't even talk about the, what is it, an MTV Music Awards performance with Rivers in his white suit?
Well, no, that was actually, it was,
was Spike, Spike TV. TV.
Yeah.
Remember Spike TV?
Video Game Awards. So, and apparently, a white suit, but, and no shoes.
Oh.
Yeah.
And the many person women's choir, the Weezerpedia says 50%. I don't think there were 50 there, but I don't know.
Wow.
It's a bit generous. And also Weezer Guitar Less. It was apparently just Dave Kushner from at some point previous, before or after, with Velvet Revolver, apparently.
Dave Kushner. Yeah, what is, I don't know, that name sounds very familiar to me.
Well, I would recommend that our listeners, if you haven't seen that Spike TV performance, I think it's pretty fun. Check it out.
So there's that one, but then there's also the one I saw just prior to watching that one, which is the Caesar's Palace from, 2013.
Ooh, I haven't seen that. I'm going to check it out.
That's coming from a phone.
Sure.
But it's pretty interesting, to scale back without the, choir. and Rivers on guitar.
Do they just sing it all the just the band, like a four part kind of harmony?
Right.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
All right, I'm looking forward to checking that out.
Definitely.
The white suit with no shoes on is very Boys to Men. Also, I don't mean to keep bringing up Boys to Men. I keep doing it.
Yeah.
I see you hate Queen, but you like Boys to Men.
Right. Sorry. I'll bring up Boys to Men until the rivers runs dry, I think it's that duo Boys to Men Weezer collab.
And then there's also the music video that wasn't.
Right.
So I watched the one that was on Weezerpedia, and they say directed presumably by Carl Koch.
Unofficial fifth member of Weezer.
Yeah. But then there's also the Wikipedia that says Warren Miller, this ski and snowboarding filmmaker. who was born in 1924 and died just 2 years ago. So I'm not sure if that's really the right person. I'm thinking it got linked badly.
People in the 20s aren't allowed to look at people snowboarding.
Okay.
That's in the rule book.
In the snowboarding rule book?
Right, yeah. If you see someone that was born in the 20s, you have to veer off the path. That's true.
You know what's interesting about the snowboarding rule book is that there's no rule that says that a golden retriever can't become a pro snowboarder. So that's
right. Yeah, absolutely.
Air. Another. Snow buddies, you're trying to say.
Okay. I guess snow buddies is really the only way to go with that.
I guess.
Unfortunately. The offspring of Air Bun.
Yep.
Air Bud plus The Incredible Journey into that, I guess. Let's make the dogs talk. It's not enough that they play sports. Come on, everyone. I'm filling up my pros and cons list really quickly, I guess. By the way, I love Queen. It's Weezer that hates Queen. I love Queen very much. It's just that Weezer hates them, and I want to go on record as saying that. I will come back if he wants to come and defend his love of Queen.
I do want to say about that video, though. That might be, I think I was on board with the, really loving the animal one for what,
Island in the Sun.
Yeah, Island in the Sun. Yeah. It's probably being, high near the top and the Muppets, too. They're wonderful, but this might be my new favorite one.
Really?
going through this process. Yeah. I mean, it's awfully simple. It's very Spike Jonze-ish. Which is apparently who they wanted, or not who they wanted, but it was possible.
Right.
Yeah.
So this is going to be skate-inspired videos.
Yeah.
However it came out, I guess. That's kind of fun. It's like a 12th segment. Like the 12th hidden 12th segment is skate video. That's kind of fun.
It's the fifth dimension.
Listen, I want a music video that is 11 more like genres of music video. That don't match what you're playing in
love
the song.
It. Yeah, absolutely.
Animated, CGI, movie inspired. Hold on. Let me get my email open.
Yeah. This is a great idea, and it's an idea whose time has come.
Rivers, I know that you have trouble with music video concepts, so here we go.
But yeah, Eric, I actually have to agree with you on this video. I saw it for the first time today when I was just looking up the song, and I don't know, but it's great. It's a lot of fun. It's a very simple concept, and I think it speaks to I like this song a lot. So how good I think the song is, and then just the charisma of the band.
Yeah, the charisma, and I think that's possibly the biggest reason I love it as much as I do is Rivers, his stance.
Yeah, for sure.
It's almost like the Riker maneuver. It's big balls. It's big balls.
Exactly.
They're so big, you got to do this.
I love it. Now I want to see Rivers walk over a chair and sit down.
You ever make a song with 11 parts in it?
Exactly.
Do we want to move transition to the left channel, right channel?
Yeah, I think now is the time. It feels it feels right. It feels good. Let's do it.
Yeah. I had a hard time hearing anything until the very, 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 very end. just this last little bit of feedback in this little outro that was only in the left.
Interesting.
Now I think in the green room, James, I think you mentioned you tried this.
So I sat there twice with my one headphone in one ear and then again, whatever. And all I could think about the entire time was, I can't hear anything. Oh my God, are my headphones bad? Oh my God, is my hearing bad? No, it's probably that this is mostly just a stereo song, but what if it's not? What if we get to this section and they're like, did you hear the secret part during the spoken word where someone was whispering underneath?
Yeah.
And I'm going to really feel sad because that means that part of hearing is gone from me. So I'm happy to hear that is not what you all heard either.
All right, well, another great segment.
What was the last channel, right channel, where something was super, super different? Or any different at all?
Back in some of the earlier albums, there was more panning to from the left to right. Right, Eric? You're like the expert. Man.
It was either early on in Make Believer or essentially at the end of Maladroit. It could have been Maladroit, you know, like with it could have been like Space Rock or something, you know, Possibilities, something like that.
Okay.
Yeah, Possibilities had a guitar solo as was left channel only, yeah.
Okay. When I hear something that's only in one channel, I assume that something is happening on a technical end from my position.
Oh, yeah, right.
Oh, no. Another set of headphones that I have to throw away now.
Yeah, or even more terrifying, like you were saying before, like maybe there's something wrong with your hearing. That's where my mind would go, too, yeah. Now I'm scared to hear different things in the left channel and right channel because I'm like, oh, no, is my hearing going in my right or left ear or whatever? Ooh, I don't like it.
My podcasting co-host refuses to listen to stereo, like, if there's anything, like, sometimes you can mix something so that, like, I'm in the left ear and I'm in the right ear, you know, like that. She's like, do not do that. I swear to God, like, make it mono and then ship it. And, like, I've forgotten a couple times. She's like, I went in and fixed it. And I'm like, okay. Thank you. And, like, it's, I mean, like, fine note. I get it. It sounds weird. But, like, to a point where she's like, no, absolutely not. That's not going to fly at all. Which, you know, it's an aesthetic for our show. So she makes sure we're consistent, which is good.
I like
it. Yeah, so definitely the first half of Make Believe.
Okay.
You know,
okay.
This is such a pity. Hold me. You know, peace.
Do you know? Have you guys on this section ever talked about the band or the hip hop group Lytyrx?
Ooh, does not sound familiar at all.
I've never even heard of this group.
So. All right, so there is a they're both on this Quantum record label. It's Latif the Truth Speaker and Lyrix Born. So they put together their Lytyrx, right?
I've heard them. Yeah.
There is an album called The Album, which is good. First track is called Lytyrx, so self-titled in a different way. If you like left and right channel shenanigans,
and we
this
do.
Is literally two rap songs, one in each channel, that work together.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's a little disorienting, but once you listen to it a couple times, it you see how it works. So that's my recommendation for the left channel, right channel folk. The people that come just for the left channel, right channel segment. For this.
And I know that they're out there. Yeah, we call them left channel, right channel leads. Right, left channel, right channel heads. Yeah, that's what we call them.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm one of them. I'm the main one. Yeah. I love it.
LCRCH, sure, for sure. Absolutely.
Yeah, exactly. I can't wait. I cannot wait to listen to this song. That sounds right up my alley, the one that you're talking about.
I bought it on iTunes I read about it on an internet page, like a blog or something, and I was like, I don't know, this seems like worth my money.
Sure.
I guess we'll see, and it absolutely was. But also very disorienting, but still very good. I think you'll enjoy it.
Well, speaking of also disorienting, Flaming Lips. Zyreka.
Oh, sure, Quadrophenia. Or no, that's the Who again.
Yeah. Right. Zyreka.
Zyreka, right. Yeah.
Yeah.
I haven't listened to that.
Okay.
I do know it. I don't have three other friends, though. So.
No.
This has been the Left Channel, Right Channel Report with Derek Nash.
All right. How about, let me ask you a question, Eric. Can I ask you?
Yeah, sure.
Is this song on Rocksmith?
One, two, three, four.
We're gonna find out once and for all. Is this song on Rocksmith?
Yes, it is. Yeah, so
very
that's
good.
Definitely something I'm looking forward to soon. I haven't gotten to it yet, but
It seems like it would be very difficult to.
What is
wrong
with
that?
And as a CDLC, so Rocksmith is, you know, we had Rock Band and Guitar Hero way back in the day there.
Sure.
So, it was like about 2011 was the first version. 2014 released another one, and they just announced recently Rocksmith Plus. So it's using your real guitar.
Oh, okay.
Plugged in with a special cord, and I think apparently with the Rocksmith Plus coming out soon, it's going to change over to a subscription service instead of buying a bunch of DLC all separately. Apparently that's gonna utilize you know, your phone and so forth, the microphone on that,
and
other ways than rather than just the cord. But they even actually introduced that at the end of the Rocksmith 2014 shelf life. They added the ability to plug in, you know, a microphone instead of it's that way for like acoustic guitar essentially.
That's really cool.
It can tell what you're playing. You know, and let you know on screen visually, you know, that you've played something wrong with a little exclamation point, I think, if I remember right. You know, and you can go back and study it and see what you did wrong.
What a time to be alive.
Yeah.
It looks like this was also available as DLC for Rock Band back in the day, too. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, and that would actually make sense why it then people, fans, users of Rocksmith, then created the custom DLC.
Right. They're like, I was really good at this on Rock Band. We need to get it back.
Yeah, and that actually brings me to that. I have played. I remember in college, I found online The Who's A Quick One While He's Away.
Nice.
Tabbed out, and played that some. Tried to learn many of the segments. Some of the segments were a little. more complex and tough, but some were easier.
And now at last we know if it's songs on Rocksmith.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I didn't do any research into covers, but if you have anything, Eric, I think now is the time.
There is a song, and that's a fact. Now tell me who.
I'll go in the order that I kind of found these three. I didn't find anything. There wasn't anything through the normal, that was officially released on any kind of album or CD or compilation or anything like that. But first I listened to a YouTuber, Matt Good, and I stopped about a third way in. You know, it was essentially, it's the one guy thing, kind of a little bit like you, Martin, I think, somewhat, sometimes
sure.
At least.
Yeah.
You know, doing multiple instruments and singing multiple times to get the harmonies and so forth. But a pretty faithful replication, essentially, was the idea there by a single guy. So then I came across the standard Weezer cover project, and wow. I love that.
Oh, that's a good one.
Yeah. So that person or persons that do that, they you know, there's an issue with replicating lyrics, but you know, I think it might have been happening in some of the segments, but not all of them. You know, it's just within one song. You know, I think they were doing that a little bit for some of the segments, but not others. But then, so that's very heavily acoustic, if not totally, there was the siren sound, which I don't think we even mentioned before.
Oh yeah,
but,
yeah.
That was kind of replicated, I think, with playing the acoustic guitar, like just one string, one note, you know, but then editing it a bit, you know.
If our editor Zach is still listening to this episode, go back to the beginning and add a siren sound in the intro of the episode. Okay.
Yep.
Actually, if you could edit it into 11 different succinct theme parts, that'd be actually
exactly. Okay, this is a job for Zach. He can do it.
He's the queen part. This is
yeah.
Hey, it's me, Martin, again. Just a little context note here. Back when we recorded this episode, we had an editor named Zach who used to edit our podcast, but now I'm the editor. Anyway, I decided not to put a siren sound in the beginning of the episode because just in case someone was listening to the show in their car while getting a blowjob, I didn't want to ruin it for them by making them think that the cops were after them or something. So that having been said, back to the show.
So then a third one that I found, that I listened to again like about halfway through this time, was the YouTuber is Ben Wong, but they're calling themselves, just last year released, Quarantine Cover.
I saw that but didn't listen to it.
Yeah. So four people, probably late teens, early 20s maybe. And it seemed like, it was pretty fun just that half just to the halfway, because, one, it's live, it's them doing it live,
right.
So, and then the other thing is that, each person does different parts of the singing.
Oh, okay.
All four of them sing. And two different people actually do the falsetto E stuff. I mean, one is a girl, so.
Right. True falsetto.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, that sounds fun. All right, I'm going to have to check out that one in the Weezer cover project.
Mm-hmm. We talked about covers. We talked about covers. We talked about covers.
Oh, right on. Okay, I think that we've come to our rating segment, right?
Yeah, I think so.
So for James, I think maybe Eric already explained this in the green room, but from 0 being the worst to 10 being the best, give your liking of this song a number.
Okay. Well, do I just real quick, can I talk about it, or is it just more of like
talk about it as much as you want?
Great. Yeah. Okay, cool.
Lead up and post either one or
what I was thinking, just say the number. Okay. In terms of like their whole career, I really, really like this song. I was going to say in terms of their whole career, it's more middling, but like, I don't think so. I mean, this is a highlight of what I'm going to call the good half of the Red Album. And
no, that's 100%.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely fair.
Okay. I'm going to give it, I think a, I think a 9.21. I was told I could use as many decimal places as I needed. So
of course, yeah. That's a great rating. I think that's a beautiful rating, and I'm here for it.
I think that it shows off Rivers' songwriting talent. I think that it is kind of footloose and fancy-free in a way that he hasn't been since maybe 96 or so. Like, in sort of like a, hey, I can have fun writing songs. Like, I think he's a great songwriter. I think a lot of times he doesn't have a lot of fun writing songs. And I think that this was on display as, let's have some fun.
Yeah, I think that's one of the best qualities of this song, is that, like, whatever, all the crazy parts and stuff, it is fun. It's fun the whole time. I have a good time listening to it every time.
I wonder if Van Weezer and, like, the Teal album and stuff, like, more recently, is him embracing his lesson. None of us are getting any younger, except Patrick, and I don't understand how that's happening. But,
well, he was born an old man. So.
Right, he has that the nanny, the crap.
Jonathan Winters' character, which was
his name.
He was an old man, and he played.
It was something. It was It's like miserable. It's not that. It's mirthless or. Hang on, this I know. I'm so sorry. You've podcasted before. Hold on one sec.
So Mork is an alien,
right? So
and on his crazy backwards world, the men
of
give
Mork
birth.
And Mindy, mirth.
Yeah.
It's mirth. It's just mirth. But it's Earth with an M, not mirth like.
Yeah.
Anyways, I think that like I wonder if he's like, let's do an '80s cover album. Let's do a more metally, riffy, meatly album. Mm-hmm. And I think good for him.
All right. Do you want to go next, Eric, or should I?
I can go.
All right. Let's hear it.
I feel like I would give this a 9.5, but I will deduct a half point because of, you know, my love of and just seeing, like, okay, it's been this kind of stuff has been done before a bit, you know, the multiple segments, you know, sections of a song. So go down to 9 for me.
All right. The 9 is also a great rating. Oh, yeah. I think that I don't 100% agree, as you will find out momentarily, but I think it's a very good rating. I a very respectable rating, Eric, as always. And my rating, I'm going to go with a 10. I think this is just a banger track. I think it slaps hard, and I love it. And, 10 out of 10.
You don't like it, you love it.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
There is no right, there is no wrong. It's just how we feel about a song. And when we feel like we feel about a song,
So, yeah. I think we pretty much talked about it. I think there was so much that to talk about, so much to cover in this song. It took me, like, when I was writing out the I always write down the lyrics in a little notebook, like, by hand.
Wow.
It's for me to, like, so that I remember them or whatever for the show. I love picturing you being like,
soon I'll be playing in your underwear. Okay, what's the next one?
100% true to life. Exactly what happened. Like, that is real life, for sure. And, yeah. But it took me, like, 20 minutes to, like, write out all the lyrics.
Yeah.
There's, like, a lot of them for this one. So, yeah, there's a lot to talk about. Yep.
Sorry. Back in the day, that was this. I had the same thing happen with El Scorcho. I remember sitting at our kitchen table with my Discman.
Yeah.
Rewind. Okay. And then I had to ask my friend who's a fan of wrestling about the wrestling references and all this stuff. So I was spelling things right. Yeah, it took a long time. Yeah.
Yeah, God damn you half Japanese girl.
Right, yeah, exactly. Yeah. All right, and Green Day, I know that one. What's the next one?
Yeah, so let's, do you have anything that, your podcast that you want to plug, James, or like any other projects that you have that you'd like people to know about?
Sure, yeah, just really quickly, I love podcasting so much, so I sort of toss myself into any good idea that I think of a title for is viable for podcasting about. I do a music podcast with my friend Daniel called Frankenstein's Jukebox, where each episode is about a year of music going backwards. So we're in the 2010s. We're actually recording 2015 on Thursday. And we each pick and if we have a guest, they pick one too, a song from that year and three things about the song that we like. And we share our songs and share the three aspects that we picked. And then we conceptualize and usually, up until this point, we every time write that new song.
Oh, wow.
So Daniel is a very talented, like, musician, and I'm turning out to like songwriting a lot. So we've been having a lot of fun with that. And the other one I want to talk about is Timeline Scavengers, which is my friend Colin and I going through the Marvel Cinematic Universe scene by scene in the historical order of when the scene takes place. So we started at the beginning of time, and we recorded late 19th century and early 20th century, four episodes of that this earlier today. It's going to take – we basically were like, we want a podcast forever, and we want a concept that will literally take for literal ever. Yeah. So that's what that is.
I think Eric and I might know something about that.
Hey, and listen, the thing about this podcast is room for guests. There is lots of space to have people on. You are both formally invited come on, because we have some space available in this thousands of episodes.
Sounds great. I love both of the ideas of these podcasts. The first one sounds like more just to my taste because I like Marvel movies, but I'm not like a huge fan or whatever.
Sure. We also just real quick, we do the Marvel Cinematic Universe and anything that has been an official TV show since that started. So like Agent Carter, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Cloak and Dagger, Netflix, Marvel shows, that stuff.
So now, you chose to do that way, and you may end up having the issue that we went about going ahead and avoiding for this show.
Okay.
By doing chronological instead of alphabetical, which was the real, inspiration of alphabetical. So what's going to happen when they put out stuff that happens that you've already covered?
Yeah, that has happened. We planned for it.
Because
Loki came out on Disney Plus recently. So we built that into the concept of our show. Our episodes are not called episode one or whatever. They are the year that it takes place.
Okay.
And if like 79 AD happened on the most recent Loki, and we've already passed that. So we recorded it and Colin put it in where it goes. Like we published it on 6/21 and then the 79, we put it 6/21 at 4 a.m. So it happened after, but before the other one, we have it all. That's what we're hoping for. Wow. I am so excited for all these Marvel things that are going to come out and absolutely screw like this Loki thing. We were like, this is going to mess with our timeline really a lot. And then we watch this and they're like, reset the timeline. And we're like, are they listening to us? What is this? Could not mess with the timeline more, and I love it. Yeah, so we built it in because we knew that was going to happen, and I can't go forward if I'm like, but what if, I have all this glass stuff set up. What if there's an earthquake? It's like, we're hoping for an earthquake. Shake us up. Do a whole movie series set in the 12th century. I'm here for it. Stone Age Avengers is a literal thing that's a comic book that I would be absolutely down to see a movie of. So, yeah. Stoked about that because it's very, very niche-y and nerdy and invites the chaos. So.
All right. Well, check it out, listeners. True believers.
Exactly. It's my favorite thing right now. I love it's that thing where I love talking about it, so it's like I talk about it maybe just a little too passionately, just sometimes.
You know what, without the passion, what is a project? What's even the point?
You can't spell podcast without certain letters that are also in passion. That's what
That's true. That is 100% true. All right, Eric, you got anything? What else do you do?
Like I already mentioned Almost Famous Minute, but then there's also a previous to that was Watchmen Minute. So they're both in the Movies by Minute genre, and everyone should check those out, hopefully. We do also want to send people to, for this show, facebook.com/feelslikeweezer is our page that you can like, and our group is the Feels Like Weezer Listener Society.
Can I put in my... I don't know if someone wants to edit I forgot to give anything at all. My Twitter is at @unabashedjames, and my podcast network is Scavengers Network, which is at scavengersnet. You can see all of the things that I mentioned. I keep forgetting our Frank's on Jukebox isn't on the network yet. You can see that. You can see Timeless Scavengers and the Movies by Minute podcast that I do with my friend Aaron on the scavengersnetwork.com website. And you can hear me on one episode of Almost Famous Minute, too.
Yeah,
and you do Can't Hardly Wait Minute?
We finished Can't Hardly Wait Minute.
Oh, you did it already.
Well,
people are at it. Check that out, too. Listen to all the episodes.
We did Newsies, and then the Britney Spears movie Crossroads, is now super duper relevant. But it's weird to bring up because you want to promote your stuff, but also... and then Can't Really Wait. And we're recording She's All That Minute right now. So, having fun with that.
Mm-hmm. She's All That's a great movie. All right. I'm excited about all these projects. I'm going to check out the Scavenger Podcast Network?
Scavengers Network, ScavengersNetwork.com.
Okay. I'm going to check it out.
Please do.
And for me, I don't have a lot going on. You can check out some of my music if you liked the songs, the theme songs that you heard for the segments. The new one for the what was it?
Oh, what was the Green Album?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. A new word that I learned today. And all the theme songs for the show, you can check me out at bandcamp.com/MartinDavidTapia. And if you're in the city of Cleveland, I work in a restaurant. Come by a Cleveland Vegan Restaurant in Lakewood, Ohio, and yell out something like, yell my name is Jonas at me, and I'll look really confused. And then like 5 minutes later, I'll understand what's going on.
It's going to be weird if people are very proud of their name being Jonas, but they don't listen to this show. It's going to be rough.
Well, I'm willing to take that risk. So, yeah. Great one. Great episode.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Fun.
Okay.
Wait, who do you guys think... do you think Rivers Cuomo is the greatest man who ever lived? Or do you think... Who would you say is the greatest man that ever lived? If somebody held a gun to your head and they're like, tell me, who is the greatest man who ever lived? Like, what do you say?
Mr. Rogers.
Well, that's a good
answer. Yeah.
He's the one I've been saying for a few years now. Like, if there... I'd be the most disappointed if anything bad was ever said about him. You know, anything ever came out, much like...
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
This kind of question really gets me into one of my favorite genres of joke, which is fake youth pastor. Which is like, well, I will tell you about the greatest man that ever lived.
This is good. This is a good one.
My friend, and he's a friend of mine. So, yeah. But Mr. Rogers is actually probably the actual answer.
Sometimes, like, when I come home from work, I'll be to my wife, I'll be like, oh, did you hear the good news? And she's like, what? And I'm like, Jesus, it's Lord. And she's just like, you motherfucker.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's awesome. That's fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. Each time you do that, it gets two times more fantastic. And I want you to remember that next time you're thinking, should I do that or no?
Don't I just know it?
Do.
Yeah. I'm going to... Should I answer my own question, or should I just...
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay. Because I didn't have an answer when I asked it, but I just thought about it for a few minutes, and I'm going to say the Austrian movie director, Werner Herzog.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is just, I think, like, the most interesting living person, and just, like, I don't know, everything he's ever done seems, like, really amazing to me. So that's my pick.
I was sure you were going to say the Archduke Franz Ferdinand. Yeah. I was
the greatest
positive.
Man who ever lived. Yeah, I don't know, maybe.
Is there a biography I haven't read or something?
If by greatest you mean most important, like there definitely could be a case to be made.
That's where the word great gets, like, magazines and stuff into trouble, where it's like Man of the Year, Hitler, and you're like, I mean, I guess, but can we say it differently? Like,
yeah. the greatest man who ever lived, Adolf Hitler.
Changed. Forget it. Never mind. I'm going to back out of that joke right away.
Good for you. You did the right thing. We shouldn't have even gone there in the first place.
Nope, probably not. Sorry about that.
Thanks
for having me on your show.
Yeah, thank you. You've been a delight.
This has been a lot of fun.
Yeah. Bye, everybody. Love you.
Bye.
I want to tell you a real life story. And it all started in 1984. A place where thousands of bands have performed in a private venue where only 150 people have enjoyed up close and personal the sounds of Gary Numan, Fall Out Boy, Local H, Failure, Youngblood, Robert DeLong, BTS, Mobb Deep, Taylor Bennett, Filter, Elvi, LPX, Catfish and Embottlement, and the Joy Formidable, just to mention a few. Over 9
1,850 hours of nonstop music and interviews, all broadcast on TV stations across the USA. It's all dedicated to the new music first, not just in the studio, but from historic venues in Chicago, like the Metro, where hundreds of full-length concerts were recorded. The Smashing Pumpkins, Radiohead, Oasis, Blind Melon, Polly Jean Harvey, Jeff Buckley, and that's just the beginning. Only one TV show has this long-term history, and it's called JBTV. And I've been the host of JBTV since the very beginning. And I'm Jerry Bryant. Join me each and every week right here on Pantheon for this brand new podcast, the JBTV Podcast. Subscribe now and follow us on all the social media for the latest news and podcast listings. Get ready. I think you're going to like to binge on this podcast. Enjoy.